Hey everybody, I'm Rick Beato on today's Everything Music. It's What Makes This Song Great, episode 67. The band is Megadeth and the song is Symphony of Destruction. Coming up next. Symphony of Destruction was the first single off Megadeth's 1992 release, Countdown to Extinction. It was written by Dave Mustaine and produced by Max Norman and Dave Mustaine. Full disclosure here, I was in a band that opened for Megadeth for 5 weeks back in 1999. It was Marty Friedman's last tour with the band. And if you're watching this, Dave, I'm the guy that came on the bus and was jamming with Marty every day. Marty and I have remained friends over these past 20 years, and I actually have an interview with him on my channel. It's called Sounding Off with Marty Friedman, and I'm getting ready to do another video with him coming up soon. So the song begins with this. If any of you have been to an orchestral concert, that's the sound of an orchestra tuning up. And then this happens, which is a 4-to-1 cadence in the key of B flat. So E flat major in second inversion, then to a root position B flat major chord. And then we're into the track. Okay, let's talk about this opening riff here. So, it's going from F to E, and then it has this run. This flat 2 sound again that we hear in metal all the time. It pulls you down to the tonic. That's why the flat 2 has been so prominent in metal. It has a dark feel to it. Well, it's part of the Phrygian scale, too. Any scale that has a flat 2 has a dark or heavy quality to it. So we've got... And he puts in the palm muting to add that extra bit of heaviness, the tone changer. Once again, palm muting adds an extra heaviness because it makes the low end bloom. Let me solo some of the instruments here in the intro because I want you to hear the tones because this is a very well-recorded record. Check out the bass sound here first, okay? That's Dave Ellefson. Now, that is a really bright tone, and you can tell that he's palm muting on it, but it has a beautiful low end to it. Here it is with the drums. Listen to the bass and drums. Let's hear the drums by themselves. Kick drum is huge. It sounds like a sample. Big, big kick drum sound. Perfectly detailed sound. It's got great top end, but it has a big, big fat low end too. And then here's the guitar solo. This is the main guitar riff solo. Check it out. Okay, so that goes along with this. There's a little sound effect that happens here. A little static effect that gives you that same rhythmic accent pattern. And here's the vocals solo. Check it out.
You take a mortal man and put him in control.
You notice there's a lot of bottom end of the voice. He's right up against the mic. You're getting the proximity effect. It's incredibly well produced. And that's part of this whole series. Not only talking about what makes the song great from a writing perspective, from an instrumental perspective, but also from a production perspective. How does it sound? Does it break new ground? Is it sonically impressive sounding? And this is really sonically impressive. Dave Mustaine and Marty Friedman are incredibly good guitar players. Dave's a very good rhythm guitarist, and we know that Marty not only is a great rhythm guitarist, but he's one of the greatest rock soloists ever. He's one of my favorites. I love his playing. When he gets to the main guitar riff, the guitar is actually split into two parts. Let me play them both. This is the main part that you know. We'll be right back. Let me actually put the drums in with it so you can get a time reference. I'll back up a little bit. That goes along with this part. Check this out. You might not know this one here. This is we got the harmony lines that you hear in there. Now here are those two parts together. Those little harmony parts jump out because that sound is a lot more mid-range. It doesn't have the bottom end of the two main hard-panned rhythm guitars, but the extra mids that it has push it forward and make those little harmony lines jump out. So let me play those with the drums once again so you can get a sense of where the time is. So the guitar riff here starts with the low E palm muted, and then it does this chromatic descending fourths along with a little hammer on from 5 to 7. So it's that's the main riff that happens, and then you have the harmony part that goes with it. Let me play along with it. People's hands up. So the riff into the chorus is played in unison by everyone. It's all palm muted except for the D. Like that. Now listen what the bass and drums play. Bass is playing really short bass notes, isn't it? And then the bass goes into this walking line that we're going to talk about in a second. What I love about this riff that leads you into the chorus is that there's a big gap in the vocals there so that it has all the room it needs to drag the listener into the chorus. Okay, let's check out my favorite part of the song, which is the guitar riff in the chorus, because this is one of Megadeth's best riffs. This is actually a really, I think, really inventive riff that happens. And then the bass line that goes with it is incredibly cool, too. There's a walking bass line that intersects with it, and it just makes it move perfectly. Let's check it out. There's actually two guitars. I'm going to play it with the second guitar in with it. Check it out. It has a little bit more mids, makes that line jump out. Listen. Okay, let's talk about that riff. It starts with the low E, and it goes through a series of chord changes. There's your E Lydian sound, and then it goes to D over E, and then down an E major triad, and then it goes to this C Lydian over E, and then it goes down this B minor triad. What's beautiful about it is it's really beautiful. Minor to E major. That's really what's happening there. So next, I want to talk about the bass part in the chorus. It has this walking line that works perfectly with the picking part. Check it out. Let me play it with the drums so you can get a sense of how it goes together. Let me play along with the whole track. I'm playing the bass through my new Alpha Omega 900 head and a 2.8 Ampeg cabinet. I love this head because it's basically a head version of the pedal that I've talked about on here many times. Let me play the bass part solo. I've tried to match the tone as close as possible. 2, 3, 4. Next, I'm going to solo the vocals and the chorus so you can hear the harmony parts put together. Let's check it out.
Just like the Pied Piper led rats through the streets, we danced like marionettes, swaying to the symphony of destruction.
These are really well-sung harmonies. They're mainly based on thirds. They're perfectly blended. If you listen to the levels of the two parts together, that's exactly how you should blend harmonies. Duck the harmony back just a little bit, maybe 3 dB lower than the lead vocal, and it blends perfectly. So you come out of that right into the verse here. Check it out. Does that one tag, then the verse.
Acting like a robot.
So it goes through the verse, and then we're into back to the riff. It acts as the pre-chorus. Chorus. Okay, so this chorus is pretty much exactly the same as the first chorus, but after we come out of this, we go into the guitar solo, which is Marty, and it's killer. Let's check it out and then talk about it. So here it is by itself. Okay, let's talk about this solo. Now, I don't want to teach it note for note. It's not really my style. It's Marty's style. And like I said earlier in the video, I got to jam with Marty every day for 5 weeks. And we talked a lot about playing, a lot about his use of odd groupings, of arpeggios, things like that. And I want to talk conceptually about what he's doing. So let's take it from the beginning here. I'll play along with a little bit of it, but I want to talk, when it gets to some of these arpeggios, talk about what he's doing. Okay, so right there in the A minor chord, he's hearing it as an A minor 6 chord, and he's playing this kind of a sound. 1, flat 3, 5, 6. So that arpeggio is really a sound that you hear kind of in gypsy jazz, for example. And Marty is so fluid with those kind of sounds right there. That kind of a sound is what he's playing right there. The next lick he uses has an odd grouping in it, this one. So there's two different sequences that he's playing that are really cool. So he's going, that's the first one, and then that one, that he's using those, that flat five here, and then. And then he goes up into the high register and he goes into this arpeggio, G major arpeggio. He's going. And then. And one of the things that Marty showed me is that he plays a lot of arpeggios like... where he has that string skipping in it. Things like that, where it sounds really fluid because of the fingerings that he's using. I love that part of his playing. It's a great lick. Once again, totally Marty kind of line. I love how he comes back to the blues here, right at the end. There, and then. Killer solo. So after this first ending chorus, there's an out chorus tag that goes into a quasi halftime. You'll hear the drums and the bass change. Check it out. Right here. Then. Then the real tag. One thing I want to point out in this halftime section is how the bass climbs to a different octave. Let's check it out here. I'm going to solo the bass and drums. Listen. Lower octave. And then up the octave. That's all for now. Please subscribe here to my Everything Music YouTube channel. Remember, if you're a new subscriber, ring the bell to get all the notifications. If you're interested in the Beato book, go to my website at www.rickbeato.com. You can follow me on Instagram at rickbeato1. And if you want to support the channel even more, check out the Beato Club. You can find out information on my website. Thanks so much for watching.